I'd also like to publicly thank several people who are here and some people who are not. Rick Iserman intended to write the biography that I wrote. For personal and professional reasons, he couldn't do it. And when he found out that I was interested, he said, by all means, and matter of fact, it was highly complimentary, he said, there's nobody I'd rather see do it. And he gave me four cartons of research material to get me started. So I thank Rick for that. Dave Keough has been helping me since I wrote my dissertation, started researching that, I guess, about 1988 when I retired from the military. And he's helped me through four books. And he, with the last one, he also read the penultimate copy. And you know the way writers always say, the responsibility is mine. The responsibility for what is right is mine. If I make any errors whatsoever, it's his fault. He read the penultimate copy. Jim McNally was responsible for somehow transforming photographs that I find on those desks in my research, and magically, through electrons, they pop up again in the middle of the books that I've written. And I want to thank Jim for that. I want to thank all of you for passing on the third martini tonight and coming here in the rain. Here's my plan for this evening. One, I'll tell you why I wrote the book. Two, I'll sprint through this chronology, which is essentially his life. I hope to give you some of the context for some of the readings I'll be doing. Catherine Olling Hollister Smith, his wife, you'll hear a few things about her. The fourth thing I'll be talking about is the 1937 intelligence coup and the 1939-1941 aftermath of that in Washington. And I'll have a few things to say about the war years 1939 to 45. And then I'll talk about very briefly about his retirement. And he played a key role as a midwife in the founding of the Bundeswehr. Then we'll go to Q&A. First of all, why a book about an obscure army officer? The person responsible for that is Dick Summers. He's in this room right now. In the year 2008, when I presented here on the Depew book, he said, what's next? I said, my Vietnam novel. And he said, Henry, you really should look at the Truman Smith papers. If you remember Uncle Remus and Brer Fox and Brer Rabbit, Brer Fox was often deceived by Brer Rabbit. On one occasion, Brer Rabbit said, don't touch the tar baby. I beg you, don't touch the tar baby. And the fox touched the tar baby and got terribly wrapped up in it. And that's what happened to me when I explored the Truman Smith papers. I couldn't let go of them. So the sources were readily available here. An unpublished long memoir by K. Catherine Smith, Truman Smith's papers, including a 43-page document called Facts of Life, his record at the Army War College in the class of 1933, the academic work he did, the entire academic year holdings are in this building, and I use them. There are photos, articles, papers, letters, and so forth, a mass of them right here, and that got me started. Third, I have an interest in German history. Always have, don't know why. And here was a chance to review a chunk of German history again. Then, of course, it's just pure serendipity. He served in the 4th Infantry. He served the 27th Infantry. He was an attaché in Germany. He married a girl from New York. I did all of those things. He was in France with the 4th Infantry. I was in Bamberg, Germany. He was in Hawaii with the 27th Regiment. I was a kid in Korea. He was an attaché in Berlin. I was an attaché in Bonn, Germany. And we didn't marry the same girl, but the girl I married just a few years ago is here tonight. And furthermore, I thought Smith was worth more than being a footnote. There are a lot of valuable insights I gathered in doing it. So let's sprint from 1893 to 1970. He's born in 93 at West Point to an old Yankee family. The first of the Smiths came over, just missed the Mayflower, came over in the middle of the 17th century as an apprentice servant, made good. And in the course of time, the family established many of the towns in Massachusetts and Connecticut, down to the time of his grandfather and namesake, Truman Smith, was a senator from Connecticut. he owned some property in Connecticut that had been in the family forever and probably still is. He wasn't filthy rich, but he was well-to-do, well-fixed, and his wife also came from a family that was well-to-do. His father was killed in the Philippines in 1900. Edmund Smith, his father was a captain, United States Military Academy graduate, 1879, Indian fighter, two teaching tours at West Point. He taught math at West Point. served in Puerto Rico during the Spanish-American War, had an administrative job in Puerto Rico. When the 19th Infantry was ordered to the Philippines, he immediately asked to return to his regiment so he could join the regiment. He did. One day on a patrol with two rifle companies, it was late in the day in the Philippines. It was time to bed down his troops. He looked at the hillside, saw some huts, took a small recon party. The main body waited while he went up to check out the area for its suitability to remain overnight, as we say, R-O-N. While going up the hill, they drew fire from insurgents. He was gut shot, survived for about 12 hours, painfully dragged through jungle, never got back to a permanent establishment before he died. an eyewitness and reporter of this incident was Corporal Benjamin Fulloy of G Company. Fulloy was later a major general, a pioneer in aviation, and he was chief of the air service in World War I for a while, and still later served in Berlin. In 1920, he met the son of the man he had, his company commander who was killed in the Philippines. Truman was in Berlin. A private, Lewis Gideon, when his company commander was shot, said to his buddies, "Get the company commander back to the main body, I'll hold these guys off." He did. Gideon received the Medal of Honor for his actions that day. That's just a little sidebar. 1915, Yale graduate. Archibald MacLeish was a classmate. Secretary of State Dean Acheson was a classmate. He had many rich and famous contacts, at least one in Hawaii. He spent his postgraduate vacation in Hawaii. Not everybody did in 1915. his buddy, Brad Coley, had a son who married Truman Smith's daughter, all of them very Yale, all of the males, of course. 1916, off to the Texas-Mexican border with the 12th Infantry, a New York National Guard outfit that was really a gentleman's club and not much more. he goes off to Columbia to study history, by the way, right out of Yale, and he joins this National Guard outfit, and it's federalized, so he terminates his studies at that time. And I want to read to you, that was the idea that we had originally for the Kleber meetings, was to read something from the most recent books. Catherine, known as Kate, whose friend saved dozens of letters from Truman that describe his adventures in Texas between 7 July 1916 and 26 December. She gets to their essence in her own words, quote, "Disorder, unpreparedness, and downright ignorance of the task of the New York National Guard. No need for amplification from me." She says of her future husband, "He was rather inclined to spend his future life as a professor of history. His mother urged him to study law. There was also a pull to follow in his father's steps to take up the profession of the soldier. Events decided for him, and he went off with his regiment just a few weeks before he was to graduate from Columbia with a master's degree. He never completed that degree, but he was predisposed to be a historian. And a letter of 7 July 1916 provides the basis of Kay's comments about the disorder. Quote, "Tents had been forgotten. The troops were hopelessly exposed to dirt, hot, dusty places." And quote, "Our battalion was forgotten by the powers that be for the last 2 days of the trip down. The officers, quote, had to buy our men food from our own pockets." Later in the letter, he says that the regular army exams were to be held in a month. He took the exams and passed them. And he said, "I'm praying for war." Of course, the war in Europe was going on at the time. he goes regular, and he says in an 11 August 1916 letter, "What a change. Comfortable quarters, good food, and soldiers that know their business." He's describing the profound difference between the regular 26th Infantry Regiment he joined and the National Guard regiment he left. It was amateur day at the fair, and even in his adventures in Europe during the First World War, there were administrative and logistical glitches that show that the U.S. Army wasn't very good at that sort of thing. He said, "We officers knew little." Belmont, you know, Belmont Racetrack, well, one of the Belmonts offered an aircraft to the 12th Infantry National Guard outfit going to Mexico, but they turned it down. What the hell would anybody do with an aircraft going down to Mexico? There's a Van Cortlandt Park in New York. Van Cortlandt was a member of that outfit. The Fish family is members of that that outfit. All of the Social Register of New York belonged to that outfit. They knew about everything but soldiering. In 1917, he marries, and I'll have more to say about that in a few minutes. I'll skip over that. 1918, he goes to France. In France, he was recommended to the DSC. It was downgraded to a Silver Star. He experienced extremely intense combat in October of 1918. And he performed very well. I have 43 letters to Kay from 2 May 1918 to early November 1918, but there was not a word from him from the 25th of September until the 7-page 3 November letter arrived. Truman sent it from a hospital. And I'll read some excerpts from his adventures in October. Here's his letter, quote, "It's been over a month since I've written, a long, hard month, and I haven't had the heart to write, as it couldn't be a happy letter, and as I could give you no assurance for even a minute in advance." That's the opening sentence, and he's writing it from a hospital, base hospital 25 in France. A 7-page narrative follows, which I won't read to you. "I love you lots, and as it's warm and bright, I can give you a bit of the experiences of 35 days, but dear, it can just be a little bit." On the 25th of December, the division commander said, told us we were about to participate in the greatest battle in history, so they move up to the line. The ground was shell-torn so as to be unrecognizable. I never imagined such desolation. The 3rd Infantry was ordered to replace the division to its front, and later Smith would learn that a new American division had advanced quite successfully, but control of the division had been lost in the advance. In his 3 November letter, he says, "Circumstances required a daylight relief on ground visible to the Boche, and so it was costly." He says, I had my gas mask on for several hours at a time, 3 nights, and realized how many narrow escapes one can have without getting hurt. On the 6th of October, we went over at 5 a.m. without artillery preparation. It was very bloody. My battalion was an assault battalion, and before we got near the Boche, we had to pass through their counter barrage. Wasn't pleasing, but necessary. D Company lost all its officers, B Company all but one, and C Company several. My spirit sank. It was so dark, we were so few, and there was no one to the right or left. Then, out of the woods to our rear, came a flock of tanks, belching fire, and we hurrahed and laughed, for they looked all the world like happy-go-lucky hippos. He goes on with describing knockdown and drag-out combat. Three of his lieutenants were wounded. In his company, he had 100 casualties out of a company strength of 250 in one day. 100 out of 250 in one day. Later, a compilation of statistics revealed that on 30 September, the troop strength was 3,662, and on 31 October, 1,843, 50% in 1 month, 50% of their strength was lost. Casualties among key leaders made Smith the commander of a bunch of odds and ends. He commanded six companies of the 4th Infantry. Remember, he's 3 years out of Yale and a captain. He commanded six companies of the 4th Infantry, a company of the 6th Engineers, four companies of the 30th Infantry, three companies of the 38th Infantry, elements of a machine gun battalion. This composite force numbered 900 men. To command these various units, there remained less than a dozen officers. So heavy had been the officer casualties in the 3rd Division. His commanders retained him in command even when some senior guys came in. My point to you is that he had a very brief but extremely intense combat experience. Weather was atrocious, dysentery, all of that. But he doesn't lose a sense of humor. He talks about killing 400 cooties and so forth and so on. He was recommended for higher award, but he was given the Silver Star. When the war came to an end, he spent about 10 or 15 days trying to rejoin his organization. The administration was such that nobody knew where anybody was, so he wandered around until he finally caught up with his 4th Infantry. let me abbreviate. When he gets to his organization, within a matter of weeks, certainly months, he's bored stiff. A Colonel Hunt, who was responsible for military government and civil affairs in Koblenz, asked him if he would like to join him. Hunt knew Smith's father, Edmund, from previous experiences in the Philippines and elsewhere. Smith joins Hunt, and as a matter of fact, Smith is largely responsible for writing something. The short title is The Hunt Report. It was really a civil affairs book of 18 chapters edited by Smith. Eight of the 18 chapters were written by Smith. And that document was resurrected in 1944 when Germany was to be occupied again by the U.S. Army. Matter of fact, when Smith was a student in the class of 1933 at the War College, which was then in Washington, of course, Hunt came and spoke to the class. While there in Koblenz, he had direct dealings with the Germans and rather fell in love with Germany at that time. His wife rejoined him after about 17-month separation from April of 1917 to 1918, April 1918, until September of 1919, 17 months. They'd only had about 9 months together before he was sent over to Europe. Let me read you some excerpts from his experiences in Koblenz. Significant is his suspicion that the United States of America has no business in Europe. here's a letter from 3 April 1919. He's writing to Kay, his wife. As for the peace conference, I'm sincerely hoping the peace be of such a nature that there will be no more American troops in Europe. I'm keen to leave the army. I don't want to leave Kay anymore. He's mooning about his bride. I'm studying German quite hard, and I'm getting now so I can read the newspapers. Still, I'm not as good at it as I am in French. Colonel Hunt is a very able man, an excellent man to work for. Bolshevism is the great question of the day. The government in Germany is just able to keep its head above water. And he explains that the government is hard pressed by Bolsheviks who gather strength in their fanaticism and in the moral and spiritual breakdown of the old order, the lack of food, and in the fact that they alone, of all parties in Germany, know what they want. The government must wend its way, the new government in Germany, between left and right. Its one source of strength is the old officer corps, and this, of course, isn't a very sure foundation for a future democratic state. He thinks he has the best job in Europe, but he's pessimistic about the future of peace in Europe. Quote, poor peace conference. The papers are excited that it does nothing. It is a much tougher task to make peace than to beat Germany. I counsel failure. 10 days later, he expressed doubt that Germany would sign the treaty that gave the Rhineland to France. In the same letter, he's surprised to find himself quite out of the blue promoted to major. By the way, he was recommended for that promotion after the combat, but again, administrivia resulted in the paper work catching up with him much later. Very significantly, he says, quote, I don't believe it is our genius to be able to handle a conquered people. Certainly in Paris, our statesmen are taking a more liberal, far-sighted view than the French. To leave matters to France would be to renew this debacle in 50 years. But the sum of matters here is that in governing a conquered people, we have much to learn from both the French and the British. A German said to me the other day, you should have learned how to govern us by our miserable failure in governing Belgium during the war. That is one matter all Germans admit, the horrible botch they made of it in Belgium. We aren't as bad as that by a long shot, and America will learn, Germany wouldn't. He says, life is as interesting as ever. I've never enjoyed a position as much. He loves his work. But he says, evidently some would-be humorists at Paris thought this war wasn't enough and decided we should enjoy another trip to Europe in 15 years. He's writing 1919, 1920, add 15 years, pretty close. France, that pure savior of civilization, is certainly a sorry spectacle today. Another humorist suggested Germany might sign the treaty as it is. No, I'm packing my bags tonight. We'll be on the march to Berlin in a month. He adds, P.S., this letter is not admissible as evidence in any proceedings brought against me. I've got my fingers crossed. He thought the way the French were behaving was an indication of vindictiveness. He thought that the Germans wouldn't take it. He thought in due course they would recover. Sooner or later, the Allies will split and France will pay dearly again. France is not as industrious or as virile as Germany. Her doom will come as certainly as fate, unless she sees into the future. And she has never been particularly far-sighted. Let us remember 1814, remember he's a historian. Now is an auspicious moment to begin a period of world peace, but the whole structure has fallen to the ground. I'm about prepared to see a world revolution. In 30 years, you will see I'm quite right. If Clemenceau is to have his way, we shall be in the age of Louis XIV again. Sometimes nowadays, I wonder what on earth I was fighting for. And of course, he's talking about Louis XIV when Germany was a bunch of petty, small states, and France was great, and he thought Clemenceau was attempting to accomplish that and would fail. Europe is bad business. Crush this alliance with France at all costs. I don't want a thing to do with them. There are more future wars ensured by this peace than I ever imagined. It will take Europe 15 years to settle down, and then she won't. Germany will see her old gang in power in a year. Well, in fact, 15 years later, a new gang, worse than the previous gang, had taken over. He had kind words for England, but he regarded France as hopelessly corrupt, and he's disgusted by Europe. Italy is crazy. Poland, sheer mad. Topeka, Kansas, for you and I, Katie. Notice that Smith is so upset that he puts a pronoun in the wrong case. And this is pretty serious. This is a Yale graduate. In any event, he enjoyed that experience very much. Got high marks from his boss, and was recommended for the job in Berlin. And off he goes to Berlin, and this is the early days of Weimar. Just a few quotes from that period. He and Kay take off for Berlin, and there we go. Remember what's going on in 1920 in Berlin. It's a madhouse all over Germany. There are revolutionaries, left, right, center, Bolsheviks, rightists, Freikorps soldiers. It's a terrible mess. Ben Hecht, reporting from Berlin in 1920, said Germany is having a nervous breakdown. I'll tell you about Smith having an interview with Hitler in 1922. Smith is the first official American to talk to Hitler. But in any event, Hitler says to Smith in 1922, "It is better for America and England that the decisive struggle between our civilizations, our civilization and Bolshevism, be fought on German soil." Truman Smith, 1924. "Germany is a sick nation, sick financially and economically, but still more sick intellectually and morally. Fraught with all manner of problems for Europe and the world, the probability of a patriotic, nationalistic Germany of the future must still be faced by every thinking foreigner, European or American." He says that in 1924. He returns to the States in 1924. During his stay in Berlin, he and his colleagues moved from observer status to an embassy. You remember the Americans did not sign the Treaty of Versailles. We settled a separate peace with Germany later. And so he became an attaché. For the last several years, he was in Germany, but doing the same job. And he met any number of movers and shakers in Germany during that time. From 1924 to 33, he goes to schools. He does the course at Fort Benning. He goes off to Leavenworth immediately after Benning, the following year. From Leavenworth, he returns to Fort Benning. He becomes one of Marshall's men at Benning, along with Omar Bradley and Joe Stilwell and others. let me read you some good stuff from Benning. When he first returned to the States, he goes to Fort Hamilton, and it was terrible. He was babysitting for some horses and mules, and Kay says, "Truman loathed this duty. He knew nothing of animals and cared less." But at Fort Benning, she says, for what Benny became one of the greatest experiences of our lives. Smith says, "Personally, I found the Leavenworth course to be far less interesting than the one I had completed the year before at Fort Benning." off to the War College, well, he says, Truman, as usual, worked hard at Leavenworth. Written problems were given almost daily, he notes, but he believed that at Leavenworth, intensity was confused with quality. "Personally, I found the course to be far less interesting than the one I had completed the year before at Fort Benning. I also regarded Leavenworth's educational methods as archaic. In particular, they seemed to me to present war as a chess game which was to be solved by mathematical formulas." This latter point and his criticism of the methods used would cause him soon to embrace George Marshall's methods at the infantry school, and Marshall valued Smith very much. Marshall and Smith established a personal relationship that lasts for the rest of Marshall's life. Marshall predeceases Smith. Let me skip over the other commentaries about Leavenworth and take him off to Hawaii, 1933 to 1935. It's a very happy tour. He commands a battalion of the 27th Regiment. Kay is a very perspicacious lady. Let me tell you what she has to say. While in Hawaii, at dinner one evening, Kay found herself sitting near the Navy Chief of Staff at Pearl Harbor. Kay recalls that she said to him, quote, "It gives me cold shivers to see all our fleet tucked up in Pearl Harbor. One single Japanese freighter loaded with scrap could scuttle herself and bottle you all up. There were always several Jap tramp steamers loading our waste scrap." Quite angrily, he replied, "You are a very silly woman. We wouldn't be in Pearl Harbor if there were any thought of war. Ticklish talks would be going on between us. We would keep the fleet at sea." She was just a silly woman in 1935. by this time, she's gone very regimental. While at Hamilton, she hated it. Remember, they had just come from a very influential, prestigious position in Germany, where at the age of 22 or 23, she had the responsibilities usually assigned to some middle-aged State Department matron. Because of her youth, she was there in a very small group in Berlin. Off to Hamilton, the good news about Hamilton was her parents lived on 53rd or 56th Street. While in Europe, they lost their first child. Long story, short version, the child was a little over 2 years old and died of some kind of infection of the jaw. I suspect two or three shots of penicillin today would have corrected the problem, but it killed the child. They wanted a child. She became pregnant immediately after the loss of the first child and delivered the baby in what is now Sloan Kettering. It was called Sloan Hospital in those days. But she was back on her home turf in New York. She enjoyed the Hawaii experience very much. Then a letter came in the mail. "In the midst of this happy life, a sudden bombshell exploded. Truman came home with a letter he had received from Colonel Barnett in command of the G2 in Washington, asking Truman to consider going to Berlin as military attaché. It's 1935. She says, "Of course he won't do that," was my immediate reaction, remembering the years of discomfort from 1920 to 1924. "Well, I'm thinking about it," he said. He went on to say that there were important things going on in Germany, very grave things. "Colonel Barnett thinks I'm the man he needs there now. I don't care," and she says, this is in her memoir, "I don't care for interfering wives. but I secretly hoped we would not go. I believed it would not prove financially possible. A second letter shattered this hope. It was feasible, and Truman accepted. He was ordered to Washington. We were to leave in June. While he was at Benning, he became very friendly with Adolf von Schell. Von Schell was one of the first of the German officers to come to the United States on exchange. He was at Fort Benning, where he met Smith, and they became lifelong friends. Schell saw a 14-foot crocodile. Schell stared at a black maid in the Smith household, couldn't take his eyes off her. He had never seen a black person before. Schell had a car that was always breaking down. Schell was sent off to Detroit after Benning, and in due course, rather early on in the Hitler time, he is made the, as a military officer, he is Minister for Mechanization and Motorization, and that's what he does for a while. Later on, he blots his copybook, according to Hitler, and he's put on a shelf, but that's a separate story. But they have this lifelong relationship because some German officers were coming to the United States. Marshall sent Smith to Germany in 1931. He observed operations, exercises in East Prussia at the time, met all of the high muckety-mucks in the German military, still the Reichswehr in 1931. This becomes the Wehrmacht in the Hitler time. But he knows all of the heavy hitters in the German system when he goes back as attaché. Before going, I didn't have to do this, but he did. Before going to Germany, he had to have an interview with the chief of staff. 1935, who's the chief of staff? Kay describes Truman's interview with chief of staff Douglas MacArthur as Smith departed for Berlin, saying it was what Truman had told her. Quote, "I was shown to General MacArthur. He was seated at his desk, his jacket of loud tweed, smoking a cigarette. He looked at me considering, waved me to a chair, and began pacing the room back and forth, as was his custom when considering a problem, smoking furiously. He stopped in front of me. I rose. You're very young to be going to Berlin. Yes, sir. Pacing again, I sat down. You have no rank. Yes, sir. Well, Smith, I have only this to say to you. I have long noted when young officers go abroad, they very soon end up in the British pocket. Now, Smith, my advice to you is never go to bed with a corpse." He waved me away. That was his interview with the chief. The chief's, my words, the chief's enigmatic pronouncements must have puzzled Smith as he prepared to take up his post as military attaché. After all, MacArthur had been a brigadier general when just 38 and superintendent of the United States Military Academy a year later. Smith was about to turn 42 in 1935 when he had his audience with the great man. Others had noted that as early as 1911, MacArthur was inclined to, quote, strike attitudes to impress the spectators. Okay, now the following is an excursion for domestic tranquility, mine. It's about Kay, my bride of 50 some odd years. Lydia said very often that Kay was more interesting than Truman. On numerous occasions, she said, you should be writing this book about Kay and not Truman. And by the way, she very rarely went with me on research trips, but she made two trips. We went to the FDR library, and she choked on the dust from the documents we were reading. I remember that day vividly. And she also joined me when we interviewed the daughter of Truman and Kay Smith, whose nickname was Kay Chin, little Kay, before she died. And Lydia joined me for that. We spent the day with the Smith's daughter. But this about Kay. She was a rather sophisticated lady, Kay. Catherine Alling Hollister was born in Rutherford, New Jersey on 1 January 1898. But living in the big city in her formative years and going to school there made her the quintessential New Yorker of a certain class, a type admired and envied by some and disliked, even despised by others. Truman wrote that his wife had a first-rate education at Miss Spencer's School in New York City. She was gifted at languages and knew a great deal about art, music, literature, and botany. Her parents had been to Europe on at least two extended trips before the Great War and were cultivated people. Close reading of her writings and attention to her life reveal that Kay was certainly privileged, but she was also an intelligent observer and an accurate reporter. She was a good listener, attentive to national and international issues, and adept at polite conversation. She was also funny. They married on 14 July 1917, an auspicious day for a couple of reasons, besides being Bastille Day. Truman was promoted to captain on that day. He married Kay in Greenport, Long Island. Greenport, Long Island is on the North Fork of Long Island. Very nice digs out that way, near Orient Point. They were married in a garden, and upon departure, they left 1917 in a mahogany powerboat provided by the Fish family. The Fish family had been governors and senators of New York. They went around Orient Point, over to New London, and began their honeymoon. Truman Smith credits his bride with quickly adjusting to military life. Remember, 1898, she's 19 years old. Truman credits his bride with adapting well to the vagaries of Army life. But as she moved about with her new officer husband in Pennsylvania, Maryland, Virginia, and North Carolina before he deployed to France and the Great War, she confided to her diary that she had never been west of 6th Avenue in New York City except to go to New Jersey once or twice. Most of us regard New Jersey as being overseas. That she had been nurtured almost exclusively in the gilded circle of her peers is evident in her confession that she had never met an educated person in her life who was Catholic, since in New York at that time only Irish maids were Catholic. An anecdote illustrates the effect of Kay's formerly cloistered life as well as her sense of humor. Early in her married life and new to the Army, she informed a duty soldier that something was wrong with the basement stove in the quarters the government provided the young couple. It was cold. The soldier fixed the problem. She thanked him. The next day, however, the problem recurred. The stove was cold. She informed the same duty soldier of her problem. Again, he somehow fixed the stove. It was at this point that the soldier told her that the problem, that there was no coal in the stove, and so the fire went out. That fire's needed fuel was a reality that never before required her attention. In her father's houses, domestic help attended to such matters. Kay had the good humor to confess her ignorance. On another occasion in Pennsylvania, near Gettysburg, maybe in Gettysburg, but near Gettysburg, part-time maid and cook says, ma'am, the sugar is all. Do we have a translation? Stupid, she stares at this girl and repeats it. Then finally she breaks the code. It's all gone, it's all out, there is no sugar. I don't think she threw the cow over the fence some hay. Maybe they did that in Minnesota, but maybe they did that in Gettysburg as well. After 17 months separation, she joins Truman in Koblenz. She too changes her mind about the French and the Germans. Smith was happy at his work. Everything was just fine. Kay had studied German for 6 months. Well, Kay's initial impressions of the German people, however, were negative. She loved the country, but she didn't like the Germans. She liked the greenness of Germany and remarked on its cleanliness, but she had reservations about the Germans. When a maid presumed that because Truman spoke German, he was German, she told her diary, quote, "I was annoyed beyond description. Of German men," she wrote, "almost all, without exception, shaved their heads till they looked like escaped convicts." Kay had studied German for 6 months at Miss Spencer's school. But when the war broke out, her father would have, quote, "none of that damned language spoken in this house." No doubt her views had been shaped by the drumbeat of wartime anti-German propaganda she had heard in New York. Despite Truman's numerous letters to her expressing his increasing preference for Germans and his increasing antipathy toward the French, she arrived in Germany pro-French and dubious about Germans. Later, she finds out that they held us no animosity and were indeed ladies and gentlemen instead of horrible cannibals was most surprising. Sensitive to the bias of her parents, in her letter of 4 January 1920, she said this to them about the French. "I refrain from my opinion of the French as I realize that you are still crossing yourselves every time you mention Lafayette." Kay's prose is as clean as the German countryside. The Americans in Koblenz socialized with the French in Wiesbaden and the British in Cologne. Those are the occupation areas that they staffed. Her powers of observation and her wit tend to prompt the reader to excuse her sometime haughtiness. In a diary entry dated 23 September, she describes a woman alleged to be the daughter of Clemenceau. Quote, "I didn't know that the old tiger had a daughter. Mademoiselle was a sight to behold. Her dress was up to her knees, belied her face, which clearly was not that of a young woman. A marvelous coiffure crowned her large head, and jewels spread themselves all over her expansive bosom. Her brilliantly painted face beamed coquettishly at the tiny French officer who was nobly dancing with her, and dancing under difficulties, for that expansive bosom completely eclipsed his view of the ballroom." Maybe Lydia was right. Maybe I should have written this entirely about Kay. She says, "The French are the most militaristic in Europe, a copy of Germany before the war." Kay's own observations and personal experiences confirmed for her what Truman had been saying in his letters. She wrote that love of the French and hate of Germans was, quote, "so carefully fostered for so many years in the American press." She says, "French policy has been to crucify Germany," and goes on and on. But remember, I say again, born 1898, she's 22 years old. In a letter to her mother, dated 11 February 1920, she makes this recommendation, quote, "Get a copy of a book called The Economic Consequences of the Peace by Keynes. It is absolutely the clearest statement of the case one could find, but pitiless. You can't afford to miss it. A perfect description of the situation now." She's not a bird brain. She's reading the economic consequences of the peace at the age of 20 and notifying her parents. She changed her mind about French and Germans, though, as I indicated. She's prolific on booze. Oh, I'm running over. Oh, my goodness. I'm just getting wound up. Okay. She's prolific about booze. She's funny as hell about booze. She doesn't allow her officer and gentleman, during Prohibition, her officer and gentleman husband to engage in the transactions. She engages in such transactions with the bootleggers, White Lightning down in the sunny South. They both like to suck up a few martinis with dinner. And so there are a lot of boozy stories. I can see that. I'm accustomed to haranguing students endlessly, and I've already used up all my time. Let me just zip through this very quickly. The big story about Lindbergh that most people are aware of comes out of the the time in the period. The Intel coup is tremendous. In 1936, he finagles to bring Lindbergh to Germany. Long story. 1937, Lindbergh comes back. Before leaving in 1937, Lindbergh has sat in the cockpit of every German aircraft, has flown many of them, has been to the research and development, manufacturing, airfields, aircraft, so forth and so on. They have a chapter and verse, and they write what is called the general estimate of the Luftwaffe, the German Air Force, in 1937. It's an intel coup. Chapter and verse. Every bird that fought in the Second World War for the Germans, except the 110 that came along later, he had reported on. Long story, Lindbergh, America First, a lot of trouble in the period 1939-1941, between the fall of France and Pearl Harbor, the struggle between interventionists and non-interventionists is much like what we're experiencing in this country now and have been experiencing for the last couple of years. Marvelous book on all of this is These Angry Days, and I'll just read one thing from that, and then I'll be quiet and take questions, and you can ask questions about any of that stuff that's up there. But let me tell you about who is it. Next time I should be invited for 4 hours. Lynn Olson, page 18. The passions engendered by the debate between the isolationists and the interventionists were as high as its stakes. The CBS correspondent Eric Severide remembered the period as bitter and heartburning. Arthur Schlesinger said the dispute was, quote, the most savage political debate in my lifetime. He added, there have been a number of fierce national quarrels over communism in the later 40s, over McCarthyism in the 50s, over Vietnam in the 60s, but none tore families apart the way this fight did. Let me stop at this point because I know there'll be questions. Just imagine what I would have said for the rest of this presentation.
Take a few questions and answers here. We just have a few minutes, about 10 more minutes. Please wait for Rodney or myself to come around with the stick mics. And again, please be loud and keep your questions concise so that Henry can repeat them for the cameras for us.
Let me warn you that without hearing aids, when you speak, I hear muttering. With the hearing aids, when you speak, I hear loud muttering. So please be clear. Dave?
Henry, you've been an attaché, you were studying an attaché. Do you have any opinions about the qualities of a good military attaché and how Truman Smith met those or didn't meet them?
Sure. Like Smith, I loved it. I was in Bonn 73 to 77 and liked it a lot. The mission of an attaché is to observe, report, and represent. The represent part is largely a matter, by the way, in advertising I was called a spy, or Lindbergh was called a spy. The furthest thing from being a spy. You wear a uniform and you're quite visible. I think being a good student, being a good writer, being concise in the military ideal of a writer, clear, concise, complete, being socialized, and if real estate is about location, 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 the attaché racket is about contacts, contacts, contacts. Smith had those. he fought against the Germans, the Imperial Army. He saw the von Seecht army, the Reichswehr, the 100,000-man army, up close and personal, knew it very well, knew the personalities. when he went back in 35, he had also been there in 1931, again, reestablishing contact. The Germans in his early incarnation and later, were kindly disposed to Americans in general, and particularly to Smith. Smith was 6'4", I didn't mention that. His wife is 5 feet tall, and he was 6'4". He was always visible. That was a big man in those days, just before the NFL, I think. He was a very big guy and very visible. But I think his contacts, his high intelligence to start with, his good education, his linguistic skills, all of those things combined to make him a first-rate attaché. And his connections were real. Very briefly, in 1945, April, the war's still going on. He gets a letter from Hans Speidel. Long story, Speidel had been incarcerated after the attempt on Hitler's life, but they didn't really have anything on him. He was held. The French liberated him. The French were kindly disposed to him, and he contacts his old friend. A correspondence starts, and it goes on until Smith's death. And ultimately, of course, Speidel becomes the number one soldier of the Bundeswehr in 1955-56, when Germany is rearmed. So he knew a lot of the people. So the contact part went on and on and on. Further?
Any other questions?
Doctor, can you speak a little bit about the formation and Truman Smith involvement in the Bundeswehr?
Yeah, yeah. As I said, he had a lot of German friends. As the Germans would point out, nicht bekannte, sondern Freunde, not acquaintances, friends. And so he started sending care packages starting 1945, 46. Germany was a mess, as we all know. He sends clothing, he sends food, and so forth and so on. In due course, this turns into discussions of both sides of the Atlantic, what's going on. He's supremely well wired to the American elites in the military. Top people, civilian and military. He knew Dulles, he knew, you name, he knew the American. Remember, he's a patrician Yankee. On the German side, it was similar. When the United States considers rearming Germany, it starts around 1950. The first mention of it I know of is Dean Acheson in Present at the Creation says, you know, the Russians are a scary bunch. Churchill had already said the scariest thing between the white cliffs of Dover and the white snows of the Urals is the Red Army. That goes back to 45, 46, 47. Got to rearm the Hun. And so as that's a brewing, Smith is right in the middle of it. In fact, he serves as a midwife to the birth of the Bundeswehr. He knows Speidel and a bunch of other heavy hitters. He goes back and forth to Germany on orders. From the G3, the Chief of Staff for Operations and Planning. Back he goes to Germany, and when the Bundeswehr is created, his old buddy, Speidel, who's an interesting guy. The trick was to find good Germans. There were bad Germans and good Germans. And Speidel was a good German because, for one thing, he has a PhD in history. For another thing, he had been jailed by the Nazis because of the attempt on Hitler's life, but they didn't have any goods on him, but he was still jailed. He was liberated by the French. The French were kindly disposed to him. He had been an attaché in France. And during the war, he had been one of the good Germans in France. So the French were going to be the big obstacle to German rearmament, and that's another long story, but that was very, very useful. When the Bundeswehr was created, he did go back to Germany a couple of times after that. I have an appendix in my book. 1963, he goes back to Germany. He writes three letters to his daughter. It's really a white paper. The three letters are very long and describe Germany 1963. As an afterthought, he says, Bundeswehr. And he said, the Bundeswehr is the worst German military that he had ever experienced. Not because of the quality of the soldiers, not because of the equipment, all of that was first rate, but from their popular support. The Bundeswehr was singularly unpopular in 1963. I was there, 73, 77, in Germany. the Bundeswehr was still secretly unpopular with the German people. As a result of the Second World War, the German military has been suspect by Germans and 11 neighbors that are contiguous. may I say anything else about this? Anything further? There he is, the man who started all of this.
Well, Henrik, you certainly followed through excellently with that conversation that we had.
6 years ago.
You talked about leading up to World War II. What were Colonel Smith's responsibilities during World War II itself? Did the United States make the best use of his ability, or was he still under something of a shadow because of the Lindbergh connection?
It's a long story, but I'll try to be brief. In 1939, he's diagnosed with diabetes. By Army regulation at that time, he had to be medically discharged. He didn't know that. He knew German officers who had diabetes, senior officers. He goes back to the States, goes before a medical board. They say, that's it, done. The papers land on Marshall's desk. Marshall files them, and Smith is sent to the G2 shop. Marshall, who is the very paragon of virtue. The only bad thing I ever heard about Marshall was he was a cold fish. Beyond that, after all of these years and all the high positions he held, he was a very admirable character. But he just decided that he was going to override regulations. He was not going to get rid of the most knowledgeable guy about Germany in 1939 or 41. In 1941, in July, Marshall called Smith into his office and he said, I've got to retire you. Marshall, as many of you know, was getting rid of anything he thought was dead wood. Among the people he had gotten rid of was some National Guard and Reserve officers, generals. Some general was kicking up a beef saying, here you are kicking out the reserve officers and the National Guardsmen, and you're keeping Smith in violation of regulation. Smith is in July. By September, he's in Stamford, Connecticut, happily retired and writing as strategicus when the bombs fall on Pearl Harbor. When the bombs fall on Pearl Harbor, the phone rings and it's George Marshall on the phone saying, Smith, I'd like you to come back to Washington, but I will not order you. And Smith said, I never wanted to leave. And so he reports back. And in February of 1942, he's back at his desk. During the war, he was reading, well, first he was a German guru. Then he was the guy who reported on the European Theater of Operations daily to Marshall. He did this in 8 minutes. He digested all the traffic from about 4 in the morning, 3 in the morning onward. He made his presentation. Somebody else did the Pacific Theater. with his diabetes, he tried to quit twice. On one occasion, Marshall said, you're not going to quit. He says, but you're going on a convalescent leave. Provides an aircraft, and he says, Kay is your nurse. Sends him away for 2 weeks to the Southwest. They fall in love with the Southwest, by the way. Both of the granddaughters now live in Utah and Austin, Texas, as a matter of fact. So Marshall considered very important. When Marshall was presumed to be the guy who was going to go to Europe to be numero uno instead of Eisenhower, Marshall, the word came down, back to the medics, clear. Smith, even if he has to work from a hospital, is going to be my G2 in England. So during the war, he essentially reported the European Theater of Operations on a daily basis until he almost ran out of gas. At the very end of his service in 1945, Marshall, another act of kindness, says, you know, you need another year until you have 30. Puts him on convalescent leave for a year in Connecticut. He retires in 1946 with 30 years of service dating back to the Mexican frontier. Anything further? Now listen, when he kicks us out, I'm going to take up a position at one of these tables, and if you'd like to go on to midnight, I'm your man. I'm your man. And you can make up for that missing that third martini.
Ladies and gentlemen, that'll do it for questions and answers. Colonel Hardy, come on up and make a quick presentation for us.
Okay, great. This is all.
This might work.
Before I do that, this is a great presentation. So you can do one or two things. We can either stay longer to listen to the remainder of the presentation, or you can just read. But on behalf of the staff and faculty, the students of the War College, as well as the folks down here at the U.S. Army Heritage and Education Center, I'd like to provide you a small token of our appreciation for the job.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it.